Hi, I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome back to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. We're talking with Mr. Bill Oakley, and you were, along with Josh Weinstein, executive producer and showrunner, the head writer, so you did the long passel of titles. Walk me through what an executive producer is and what a showrunner is, because I it's like a gaffer or a best boy or something. People see these names and they don't really know what they mean.
Well, there's a lot of title inflation in television, and there are, when you see those credits that start with writer, story editor, co-producer, producer, supervising producer, those are all just, most of them are writers, and they're just a certain level of writer. Executive producer is the highest level, and sometimes when you see the executive producer, they're also the head writer and the showrunner. A lot of times people have, not just on The Simpsons, but on any show, there are some people who have executive producer titles who never show up, you know, who initially were involved in the financing and arranged something 25 years ago. And,
right.
The executive producer, who's actually the showrunner, is the one who calls the shots. It's sort of like being the head writer as well as the director of a movie, in that everything falls under your purview. The casting, the writing, the editing, the set decoration, everything has to be run by the showrunner.
To whatever extent you can speak to this, when The Simpsons really became a cultural force and a money-making machine, did the network take whatever hands they'd had on the show off? Did it become sort of a self-contained
That is the remarkable thing about The Simpsons, is that the network never had any involvement in The Simpsons. And it was one of the things that was negotiated in the very early days of the show, because the Fox network was just beginning. And I believe, and to lure Jim Brooks to do a show for this new network, they had to promise him that they let him do what he wanted. So Jim Brooks negotiated this remarkable contract for The Simpsons, which was that the Fox network executives could never have any involvement. They literally, all they got was a finished show that they had to broadcast.
Wow.
And they didn't come to the readings, they never saw the script. They saw the scripts, but they couldn't comment on them and things like that. And it was, to some extent, I think, one of the things that allowed the show to go to be, you didn't have to worry about pleasing the audience. We're trying to please ourselves.
Right. I'm going to have that guy negotiate my next contract. When you're writing for, well, in this case, The Simpsons, what character's figurative voice is the hardest to capture? Who is the hardest to
Bart
get?
You know, that's the thing. People always say that The Simpsons was about Bart, but it really wasn't. It was always, except for a few episodes in the early days, it was really a Homer show. And writing Bart is much harder than you think, because writing Homer is a lot of dumb guy jokes. I mean, you want sophisticated, quality dumb guy jokes, but that's not the hardest thing in comedy writing. Bart having, like, Bart's greatest prank ever. They would always advertise, this is Bart's greatest prank ever. And it would take 25 man hours to come up with a prank that wasn't one that we'd already done,
right,
that was original, but still seemed maybe like a 10-year-old boy could do it. And also Bart's voice is hard to write. It's not as hard to write as Groundskeeper Willie or something like that, but he has so much more to say. And you have to have Groundskeeper Willie, you don't have to worry about, does this match his personality?
Right.
Is it emotionally true to the character and whatnot? Whereas with Bart, you got all those strictures at once.
I suppose I'm legally required to ask this. You guys read message boards? Did you go online and see what fans said? And if you did, to what extent did that ever affect the way you would proceed in the future?
When Josh and I were running The Simpsons, it was in the earliest days of the internet. And in fact, I was one of the very first people, certainly on the Fox lot, to ever get on the internet and see what people were saying about us, because you had to have a dial-up account through a university or through a Unix provider. And I actually logged on to Alt TV Simpsons, which is still around, although I think it's more of a web-based kind of thing now, with Unix. And I had to learn enough Unix to read Alt TV Simpsons, and I was reading it in 1992 and 1993. And the problem is that there's always somebody who, even on the shows that you guys have worked so hard on, you think it's your best work, there's always somebody who hates it. And writers especially, and me in particular, are the kind of person who obsess about, if there's 1,000 great comments and one negative one, exactly. So I read it for many years, and at a certain point I stopped reading it, because even though I'm a perfectionist, the people on Alt TV Simpsons are even more of a body of perfectionists.
And yes,
it just became a little too difficult to take.
As a character on The West Wing once said about some message board folks, they're not hysterical, they're hysterical. And really, do you need to stay away? When you moved on from The Simpsons, and you know, and I think, you know, I'm probably also legally required to ask why you moved on from The Simpsons, but you stayed in the realm of animation. Tell me a little bit about the transition from The Simpsons to your projects after
that. Which question do you want me to answer first?
Well, if there's a short answer to why you moved on from The Simpsons, probably that one.
Well, we were at The Simpsons for 7 years, and that's a long time for a job that is usually it's 51 weeks a year, 16 hours a day, 6 or 7 days a week. And we also sort of felt like we had said everything that we wanted to say while we were at The Simpsons, and we didn't want to be there doing a bad job.
Retreading.
Exactly. We felt like we were already, even in the late eighth season, we were kind of treading water a little bit, and we were just, we felt like, let's leave while things are still, you know, in good shape.
So we come back, we'll talk about life after The Simpsons, where you went next, and where you're going after this. We are talking to Mr. Bill Oakley. You are watching Outlook Portland right here on Northwest 32 TV. Stay there.